Hello and welcome back. So with everything in place, I will now go through the main points of the algorithm which does our search. So to recapitulate, the aim is we want to find the model of out of the group of all possible models which has the maximum adjusted R squared value. And what we want to do is we want to use the ideas I've presented in the previous video to find the best model without having to try each and every model. So that's what this algorithm is attempting to do, and I'll now run you through the main ideas of that. Okay, so let's dive in. So the first ingredient of the algorithm is we work out the residual sum of squares for a few models in advance before we even start. And what we do here is we compute values which I call phi j in the notes, and that's the residual sum of squares for the model with just one variable removed. So in set notation, I can write it like this. So that is all variables, this is subtraction of sets, so that means I take out variable j. And then I have a model with p minus 1 variables, everything but j, and the residual sum of squares of that model I call phi j. And in the previous video I talked about this, the residual sum of squares gets larger. So any model which does not contain xj, it's called the model j, that model then has residual sum of squares bigger than or equal to phi j. And let me run through that once more, because that is kind of the key of it. So the logic was, phi j is the model which does not have variable j, but it's the largest of these models. It's only variable j removed, all other variables are still there. And we said removing variables makes the residual sum of squares larger. So any model which does not contain xj means it's either this one or it has more variables removed. So the residual sum of squares either equals that one, or if I removed more, it may have gotten worse, so it may be larger. And large means bad here. We are trying to minimize the residual sum of squares. And that's a big help. So we can already know without any consideration of number of variables or structure of the model, if xj is not in, we must be at least this large. And if we have already found something better, then we know this one cannot be the minimum because we have something which is below that value. Good. And now to make notation easier, what I did in the notes is I sorted these values. So assume phi 1 is the largest, then comes phi 2, and so on up to phi p. And that in the mathematical notation will require renaming the variables, so you may just rename your inputs. It doesn't matter which one you call 1 or 2 or 3, nothing depends on it, so we just rename them that this arrangement is what we get. The mathematician would probably say we can do that without loss of generality. Good, and in the R code, we have no such luxury in just assuming it. Then we need to do something because the user gives us the data and that may be true or not. So in the R code, if you have a look, what I do is I compute these values. Then I find out which permutation do I need to bring them in the correct order. And then I use this permutation to shuffle both the columns of the design matrix and the entries of this vector phi, which I've just computed, to just by actually rearranging the inputs to make that true. So in the R code, that is also true, but only because I rearranged the inputs using some commands. And then at the very end, when I want to get the results, of course, I need to invert that and I need to do the inverse transformation to that to translate the results back into the scheme in which the inputs are encoded. Okay, so here let's just assume that, but again, when you read through the R code, you will find code which corresponds to that at the beginning when I do the sorting and at the end when I transform it back. Let me just write that. Look out for JJ in the R code. And JJ, this one is a variable I use there to store the permutation which is required to bring the phi in that order. Good, so there it says. And now the algorithm has two loops. So the first loop is for q, the number of variables in the model ranging from, well, we would have 0 up to p, but it turns out there are a few special cases. So p, there is no savings to be done. We do that separately afterwards. And we have just considered all models of size p minus 1. They are only p of them. We have just done them anyway, so we don't need to do anything anymore because we have already done it. So on the upper end, we stop at p minus 2. And similar to how p is an exception, 0 is also an exception, so we start at 1. So that is the outer loop, and that is the size of the model. And that corresponds directly to that idea. So the loop works out this for every q, and then afterwards there is an extra step which does this minimum, but that's easy, that's just a small number of values. Good. And then the next loop is more of a trick. So for k ranging from q plus 1 up to 1, this loop is just part of the algorithm, that k is not part of the problem, and what that does is k is the index of the first variable not in the model. The not is important. And it turns out slicing it like this makes it all a bit easier. And I don't want to write the full steps here, but I want to just explain that idea. And I think after you got that, then the rest should be easy to read. So let's try the first value. I say we start with k equals q plus 1. So we have our inputs x1, x2, x3. Let me write a few, x5 up to xp. And now let's assume for a second that q equals 3. And then here we see the first k we try, and also the largest one is k equals 4. In this case, it's very easy. We know the model, there's only one, namely if we have three values included, and that one here is the first one which is not in the model, well, that means this one, and this one need to be in. And we only have three inputs in the model, so that means all the others are out. So in this case, there is only one model to check. We have to do that. So we compute R of 1, 2, 3. That's the model. And we get an actual numerical answer of that. Now comes the trick. In this example, if R 1, 2, 3, if that's less than or equal to Q3, then 1, 2, 3 is optimal for all models with three variables. That's the claim. And I think that is the only thing you need to wrap your head around. And that, I admit, is a bit tricky. But once you got that, I think the rest will be easy. So why would that be true? Well, first, it's not true because I made a mistake. So it was meant to read phi3. My apologies. So that phi3 gives a hint that must refer to that argument here. Any model j which does not contain xj has residual sum of squares bigger than phi j. And now, how can we use this? Here we have found one model which is better than phi3. Now, if you think all other models with three variables, they will be missing one of these three. So let me just write another model with three variables. It could be, for example, this and somewhere here. And whatever we do, if it's not this one, then at least one value must be back here, and at least one value must be missing from here. And let's just assume for a second, maybe the one which is missing here is that one. And here's the reasoning. Any model j which is missing variable 3 in this example has residual sum of squares worse than phi3. We have just found one which is better than phi3. So all the models which are missing this one, we are good. We don't need to fit them anymore. We know they are all worse than that because the residual sum of squares is bigger than phi3. They may be equal, but amongst equally good ones, we are happy if we find one, so we don't worry about that. So worse or equal. Good. So that's one case. There's another case, so possibly that is present, but then one of the other two must be missing, say this one. And then it's written here, any model j which does not contain x2 has residual sum of squares bigger than phi2. But now comes the next line into the game. Phi2 we know is bigger than phi3. So in this case, here we get residual sum of squares for whatever the model may be is bigger or equal to phi2, is bigger or equal to phi3 by the ordering we did, and that is bigger or equal to residual sum of squares of 1, 2, 3 by that assumption. So we operate on the assumption we have found a model which is better than phi3 by testing the first one. Good, and you can see what happens if it's the first one is missing but the other two are there, then phi 1 is also bigger than phi 3, so it works the same. So if we put that all together, it works out. So if the one model we have tested so far is better than phi 3, then the model 1 to 3 is optimal, because any other model is missing one of these three variables, so it must be bigger than one of these phis, and then bigger than phi 3, and that's bigger than the model we have just tested, so we are optimal. Good. Also just rewind the video a bit, watch that again, because that is really the whole key idea. And now, we are just doing a bit fancier versions of this. So what I just did is I showed you the case for k equals q plus 1. Now, if k equals, it's going down, so if k equals q in this example, then the assumption now is this variable is missing. And in the example, we still have q equals 3, but we have no k equals 3. Then there is no longer one model to go with this, because I drew only two black dots. So there must be a third black dot. So it could be this one, or it could be this one, or this one, and so on. You see, there are p minus 3 of them. So here we test p minus 3 models. And then we take the best one. So take best of these p minus 3 models and call it j. And then the trick goes similar with one tiny extra twist. So if rj, the best of these, is better than phi 2, then j is optimal for q. Okay, so there's a 2 here only because of the example, and we are looking at k equals 3. It is always the point left of the excluded column, so k minus 1 we are looking at. And now the logic goes the same. So if we have any other model which is not in the list we have just tested, then we have done all the models which have two variables to the left of k, then there must be one variable missing here, either x1 or x2 in the example. And then the logic is as before, this missing variable says we are either bigger than phi1 or bigger than phi2, and because phi1 is the bigger one of these, we are always bigger than phi2 for all the others, and if we have found a model already which is better than phi2, then we know all the other models are not competitive, and the j we found is optimal. Good, and now you can see how that continues. So for general j and k, we have always k minus 1 variables included to the left of k, and then a whole bunch of variables on the right. So here already for k equals 2, we would have these included, so we have this in always. And then we have two variables here, so we could have this, 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 that, this, that. And the argument then goes the same. There are more combinations to try, so every step in this loop gets harder work as we go on. But these cutoffs that completely terminate the k-loop. So it says optimal for q. So as soon as we find one of these, we are done with the k-loop, and we go back here and try the next q. So that's good. And the further down we have to go here, the harder work it gets. But with a bit of luck, we cut off early. The variables are ordered in a direction which helps with this. Good candidates are at the front, and these are very unlikely to be included. And then we play this game. If we find one with where the cutoff triggers, then we abort the loop. We have found the optimal one, and otherwise we have to go through the end. That was the unlucky case, that is very unlikely, but in this case we would have actually tried all variables. So in this case, if we never hit this early exit, then we have not saved anything, but normally we save a lot. Good, and there's one last thing I want to discuss here, namely already with these two variables to the right of x2, I started some scheme here, but it is not totally clear how to enumerate them. There are different ways. So you need to go over all combination of having two values in the set of x3 up to xp. And in general, you have q minus k minus 1 or whatever values in here in k plus 1 up to p. So there is a combinatorical problem, but in the mathematical notation, we don't need to do anything. I just write, we try them all when I write the algorithm and leave it to you how to do it. And in the R code, I actually implement the whole algorithm there for you. There I need to face this problem, but I still manage to evade it. Namely, there is a library called sets, which has a function which gives you all combinations we need here. So look at the R code, but I have a function which just says what are all combinations. So I call this function, get the combinations, and then run through the list I get from this function. Though that bit would be a bit tedious if we didn't have help, but I just use a ready-made library which does that for me. Good, and then that's how you do the K loop. You do it until you find one of these cutoffs. If that succeeds, you stop and start with the next Q. Otherwise, you do it to the end. And then you do that until you have tried all Qs. And I said it at the start, Q equals 0 and Q equals P we try separately. And P minus 1 we have already done with different notation here. So we need to find the minimum of the phis. But we know it. It's phi P because we ordered them. And now we can go back here. Now we know these numbers here. That's what we have just computed with the algorithm. And now we just need to find the minimum of p plus 1 numbers. And p plus 1 is so small, one can just go through the list or call the function min in R to get the minimum. So that has solved the problem. Good. And that's all I want to explain to you here. And I think if you think about this trick here carefully, you should do that before you try to read the algorithm in too much detail. But once you got this down, then I think the algorithm will be very easy to read. So you should read both through my description, and you should also have a look at the R code. And finally, at the end of the section, there are a few other methods which are made for the case when P is too large and that trick does no longer work. But I think nowadays these are not so important because computers are fast enough to deal with quite large P. I heard P equals 50 is still a possibility. And also nowadays I cannot really see somebody fitting a linear regression model with 50 inputs without getting tempted to fit some neural network instead or do some other thing. So I think these other variants play nowadays no role in practice. But whatever, I wrote a very short description for you and you can read that in the notes. Okay, so these are the main ideas. And now the only step left to do is to fill in the details. And for that, there are two things for you in the notes. Namely, first, I've written down the steps in detail. We have already seen these, but you should go through them again, read them again in order, and make sure they make all sense to you. And then there is also afterwards my R implementation of this algorithm. And you should probably also go through this. That uses a few commands we haven't used before, but I wrote comments to explain what they do. And it should line up nicely with the algorithm, so you should try read my R code and see whether you can line up the R code with the steps in the algorithm. And the algorithm, I think, is the final way to settle down all details. Namely, the algorithm is what my R code does. So even if the text is a bit vague and can be interpreted in different ways, the R code, that's what it is. So if there's any uncertainty in the textual description, go to the R code and look it up how I do it there. That's how it's meant to be. Good. So that is our algorithm. And there are a few more details in this section, but they are trivial compared to what we have just done. So I will leave it to you to just go and read them. So that's all for me today. And I'll see you again in a few days. Okay. Bye-bye, everybody.